Greetings, everyone! I am Lord Orochi! I'm just letting you all know that this video contains spoilers about my life! If you don't want to know about the tragic backstory that befell me, Lord Orochi, and how I became the greatest shogun that Wano Kuni ever knew, then you should not watch this video! But even if you don't, you should still watch this video to know my great tragedy! Okay, bye!
Is anyone else kind of disappointed in Orochi's anime voice? I mean, like, I get it. I do. I really do. But, you know, after just doing the voice for as long as I have, when I finally heard his real voice in the anime, which is like, Komurasaki, you will be mine. I'm like, oh, okay. Well, that's the way they decided to roll with it. I guess we'll find out how the dub goes. Okay, so today, we'll be talking about the tragic backstory of Kurozumi Orochi. Everything makes sense now, guys. All these people on this poster back here, you know, you got Luffy, you got Ace, you got Shanks, you got Whitebeard, all of them don't hold a candle to Kurozumi Orochi now. Now that we know the crap he had to go through, he is easily the fan favorite. So, I'll be honest with you, it was a little different than what I thought, at least Orochi's overall goal. I figured he was gonna have some kind of messed up backstory, because, you know, like, look at Doflamingo. A lot of people were even comparing Doflamingo to Orochi just from the little bit that we knew beforehand. When Orochi met, Higurashi at that shack out in the middle of Wano, out in the middle of the woods or the swamp or whatever it was, and Higurashi was like, you are a member of the Kurozumi clan! We have been persecuted for generations now! You know, and, you know, Higurashi provided her services, and Samimaru was there, and she provided the Yamato no Orochi Mythical Zone fruit. Here you go, Orochi, you can have that. There's a lot of comparisons and parallels between Doflamingo and Orochi in that regard. How Doflamingo, you know, he started life as a celestial dragon, then he got thrown down into the lower realm, and he was being chased after by, like, angry mobs his entire childhood. And it basically ended with Treble, you know, gathering, you know, power together, and like, oh, join our organization, and you can be our leader, you can be our king, you know, Lord Doflamingo, and then provided Dofi with the Ito Ito no Mi and the pistol, kind of in a similar regard there. It even continues further because we get a little bit more of elaboration on the persecution of the Kurozumi clan to give you a brief refresher on how that went. Orochi's grandfather, we still don't know his face or his name, but his grandfather was a daimyo, probably most likely the daimyo of the Kuri region, because during the day of Odin and Sukiyaki and everything, the Kuri region, before Odin took it over, was known as this just lawless land that was basically ruled by Ashura Doji. But it was still one of the regions of Wano, so there had to be, like, I imagine there was a government set up there, and then it just fell into ruins. It was probably the land that was ruled over by the Kurozumi. So the situation was, Sukiyaki's parents, this would be Odin's grandparents, it wasn't looking like they were gonna be able to have kids, okay? They were getting on in years, and they weren't gonna have kids, there was probably some issue going on there, and so, okay, well, if the Kozuki clan is not gonna continue, there has to be another shogun after, you know, Sukiyaki's father dies, there has to be another shogun. So they decided, all right, we're gonna take one of the daimyos from the five regions of Wano, and they're basically gonna elect a new shogun from them. Okay, so we had the Shimosuke clan, the Uzuki clan, the Fugetsu clan, the Amasuki clan, and the Kurozumi clan. All right, those five clans there. I guess it's also possible because there's, okay, right now, or at least back during, you know, when Odin was alive, the Shimosukes ran Ringo and they ran the Hakumai region. Yasuie and Ushimaru were both Shimosukes. So I guess it's possible that, like, maybe the Kurozumi clan ruled over, you know, Ringo, and then when, you know, his grandfather was removed and executed, the Shimosuke just took over both of those regions, okay? And it's actually possible maybe the Amasuke clan, which is what Toki is descended from hundreds of years back, maybe the Amasuke clan were the ones that ruled over Kuri, but then they eventually died out for some reason, and that's why Kuri ended up a lawless region. So I guess one of those two explanations could make sense. But anyway, yeah, they were gonna pick one of those daimyos, and so Orochi's grandfather, old, I think I'll just call him Pappy Kurozumi, because I have to have something to call him, old Pappy Kurozumi, he decided, hey, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm going to poison the other daimyos, so I'm the only one left, and they'll have to choose me. Because that's how that works, right? Like, alright, we're gonna select the new shogun out of the five daimyos. Wait a second, where are all the daimyos? It's only Pappy Kurozumi standing there in the hall. All the other daimyos are not there. He's like, oh yeah, they couldn't make it because they apparently died mysteriously right before this election was supposed to be held. It's like, oh. Alright, well, sucks to be them then. I guess, you know, Kurozumi, Pappy Kurozumi, I guess you're gonna be the next shogun, right? So, from what we understand, he basically succeeded. He did succeed in poisoning the other daimyos. However, it turns out that Sukiyaki's father and his wife, they did end up having a child who, of course, was Sukiyake. So he was revered as, like, the miracle child at the last minute. He was born, continuing on the Kozuki legacy. Now, at the same time when this happened, it was also discovered that Pappy Kurozumi had this plot against, you know, the Kozuki clan to take the position of shogun, right? And so I don't know how they figured it out. I mean, like, oh, all the other daimyos died and only the Kurozumi daimyo was alive. You know, who? Maybe there's a connection. I don't know. But anyway, they figure that out. He gets captured and sentenced to execution by seppuku because of his traitorous nature. He was trying to betray all of Wano and the Kozuki clan. However, this is Wano we're talking about here, and they don't just end stuff with just like, all right, the person that's, you know, guilty of these crimes is executed and then we move forward. Oh, no, 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 no. Their entire clan was basically put on the blacklist in Wano. It's like, if you are a member of the Kurozumi clan, it doesn't matter how distantly related you are. It doesn't matter if you were Pappy Kurozumi's, like, third cousin twice removed or whatever. No, you're a Kurozumi. We're gonna hunt you down like animals and, like, stab you with pitchforks and throw you into the ocean. I mean, like, this is kind of a situation, like, like, it's kind of fostering hatred, you know what I mean? Just like, hey, this person committed a horrible crime. Let's punish the innocent family members that had nothing to do with this. Even, like, not even, like, the generation of, you know, Kurozumi's, you know, Pappy Kurozumi. Like, all right, his generation was the one that did all these horrible things, so we'll punish, like, his brother and his sister and his, you know, if he has any surviving family members along that line. But we cut to, like, two generations later, you know, when Orochi is born, you know, he's his, you know, grandson, he's even persecuted the exact same way. Orochi goes on to say, like, his parents were hunted down the exact same way. Doesn't matter. Like, Kurozumi was synonymous with, like, traitors and just evil, and it's like, we're gonna find anybody that bears that name, or probably even bears, like, family resemblance, and take them out. That was the basic idea of Wano. And it's like, it's kind of like the same deal with, like, do you know how World War II started? Like, okay, I'm not gonna get way into it, because there's a lot of stuff to unpack with that statement, right? Well, actually, Tekking, but no. One of the major reasons World War II happened was the way the end of World War I was handled, alright? Where it was essentially like, alright, Germany was at fault at the end of World War I, and so the Treaty of Versailles was basically like, hey, let's just, like, punish Germany as much as possible. And so it was because of that that you had, you know, like, Hitler coming to power and stuff. He was able to, like, rally the people together because they were in such a, like, a shitty circumstance at that moment. And there's a lot of other stuff, like I said, to unpack here. That's not the only reason World War II happened, but it's, like, an impetus for what eventually would occur later down the line. That's because that's why at the end of World War II, you know, the punishments against Germany were not as severe, because that the people kind of like, oh, yeah, let's try not to keep repeating this over and over again. So, you know, that's basically what happened. Like, oh, Pappy Kurozumi ruined everything? All right, well, let's punish his family. Let's drive him into the dirt. That's the only proper punishment they can have, okay? And so, because of that, we get the main goal of Orochi here in the last chapter. He says to Odin what he's trying to do with his position of power now that he has become the shogun, now that he has all the cards on his side of the table. He basically flat out said to Odin, you know, I am here to basically run this country into ruin. You know, Shinobu said it best. He's like, he's not here to be a shogun. He's not even here to be a dictator. He's not even here to be like, I will rule over this country and my family will rule over this country for the rest of time, you know, with an iron fist. He's not even trying to do that. He's just like, no, no, you're the ones, like, every citizen of this country, once again, it's like a vicious circle. It's like they persecuted all of the Kurozumi clan, regardless of how they were connected to Pappy Kurozumi. Doesn't matter if they were even alive during the time. Doesn't matter matter if they're a Kurozumi, they're going to be persecuted. Orochi's kind of doing the same thing right now. He's like an eye for an eye sort of deal, vicious circle. He's just like, you know, well, they punished every member of my family without prejudice, so I'm going to punish every citizen of Wano without prejudice. It's only fair! So Orochi's plan is like, I'm going to run this country into the ground. He's already kind of succeeded. He's like, you know, polluting the entire area, you know, allying with Kaido, turning most of Wano into just weapon factories for the underworld of the One Piece world. He's doing all that, allying with Doflamingo and everything. He's like, we're just going to do all of that. And the only reason why, you know, the Flower Capital is still probably a nice place to live is because that's where Orochi is. So he doesn't want to go back to living in squalor himself. So Orochi's probably master plan here, as I said in the review, is like, all right, I'll bring the country to ruin, but I'll make sure there's enough, you know, enough luxury in the place for me to live in so I can have proper food and nice sake and party every night in the Flower Capital. But when it's looking like I'm about to croak, when it looking like my life is coming to the end and I'm on my deathbed, I'm going to push the kill switch, basically. I'm going to set something up with Kaido or with some other people, you know, plant explosives all over the country or some, maybe he, because he was, you know, like Kaido had connections to Caesar. Maybe he bought some kind of gas weapon from Caesar years ago. And he's like, all right, whenever it's looking like I'm about to, you know, shuffle off this mortal coil, I'm like, all right, well, it's been fun, everybody. And then boom. And then all of Wano just gets either obliterated or Kaido Boro breaths the whole thing or a gas weapon takes over. And that's like his ultimate plan. It's just like, all right, well, I can't be alive anymore, so it's time to end it, right? Now, the only problem with that is, like, all right, I don't know if Kaido would go along with that, because this is kind of his home. This is Kaido's home now, too, and it's his, like, his weapon factory and where he makes everything, so, and all of his, like, the mines are in Wano, and this is where Sea Prism is mined as well, so it's like, I don't know, like, if that's, I'm sure that's kind of Orochi's plan. I mean, he basically said it. Like, what other plan would Orochi have? He's like, I'm literally here to bring this country to ruin. Like, all right, well, then you want to bring the country to ruin, right? But Kaido might have something to say about that. But yeah, I've even seen some people comparing Orochi's story to Ace a little bit. It's kind of a weird thing to bring up, but no, if you actually think about it, it's not that too far off. It's like, Ace was somebody that was, you know, basically, you know, a lot of prejudice for him because his father was king of the pirates. So it's like the sins of the father obviously transferred to the son and the grandson and the great grandson, right? You know, sins are genetic, obviously, right? That's how that works. So, you know, you feel bad for Ace because he lived his entire life basically, you know, having to keep it secret who his father was, and he eventually grew to hate his father, and everybody around him was talking about how crappy his father was. And so eventually it ended up getting to his execution. Like, he wasn't, like, he was executed, sure, because he was the second division commander of a Yonko, right? I mean, that's, you know, for reasons to be executed just for that. But the major reason, and even Sengoku said as he was announcing to all of Marineford, like, you are the son of Goldie Roger! We must eliminate his seed from the entire world. And sure enough, even after Roger was captured, you know, they sent Marines to the four corners of the world trying to find any woman that might, you know, bear Roger's child. So you feel bad for Ace, and, you know, I feel bad for any child. I feel bad for Doflamingo, you know, being chased around. Like he was like an 8-year-old kid that was basically being tied to a house and set on fire. I mean, like, you know, now, it's an interesting thing with Doflamingo and Corazon and, you know, Homing and everybody, because Homing was a good person, his wife was a good person, Corazon was a good person, but Doflamingo was the one that turned out to be, you know, the rotten apple in the bunch. So that, I think Oda's definitely trying to go with, like, a more of a nurture versus nature argument there with Doflamingo, where I think Oda's kind of trying to make it out to be like Doflamingo was born like evil, like the way he was. Like, even though his family for the most part were very nice compared to other Tenryubito, Doflamingo ended up that way. But we don't know the whole story behind Doflamingo's upbringing. Maybe Doflamingo was, maybe his father tried to put him on the right path, but maybe Doflamingo snuck off and he was talking to somebody else, another Tenryubito, and taught him how Tenryubitos really should live, and that maybe that's how he got the ideas in his head. Not really sure how that worked with Doflamingo. But when the case with Ace and the case with Orochi, even Orochi didn't even know the reason why he was being persecuted as much as he was. He didn't find this out until he met Higurashi, and Higurashi explained that you're a member of the Kurozumi clan and everything. That's why, you know, you're being chased after and attacked and everything at every angle. That's why your parents got killed. That's why all your family members are being, you know, wiped out of the country, because you're a Kurozumi. Orochi might have not even known, you know. Sure enough, like, if you are a member of the Kurozumi clan and you have a child, you're probably going to try to keep that on the down low as much as possible, right? You're probably going to try to keep it as much of a secret as possible that you're a Kurozumi. Kind of the same thing with, like, Kawamatsu and his mother. Kawamatsu just told him, you know, you're not a fishman, you know, because they get persecuted. You're a Kappa. Just say you're a Kappa and everything will be good, right? So maybe along the same lines there. So Orochi just lived his life running from place to place, you know, no real home, hiding in, like, the woods or in, the ditches of Wano under the bridges, and people are always chasing after him. I'm assuming there's a family resemblance here because Orochi has a very distinct appearance with, like, the buck teeth and everything. Maybe his grandfather looked very similar, and maybe all the members, I guess not all the members of the Kurozumi clan, because Semimaru and Higurashi are also apparently members, and they don't look exactly like Orochi. But maybe, like, Orochi, like, is from the main family, and Higurashi and Semimaru, they're from, like, more of a branch family kind of deal. And so maybe his father, his grandfather and his father looked very similar to Orochi with the teeth, and so they saw, you know, little kid Orochi, and they started, all the kids and all the adults of the island started chasing, it's time for the Kurozumi hunt again, you know, like, something like that. So, I'll be honest with you, I'll give you one thing from Orochi's perspective, I'll tell you one thing, dude's got conviction. You know, like, you can't say he doesn't. Dude has got a massive amount of conviction where he finds out when he's a little kid, I'm a Kurozumi, this is why people are persecuting me. And now, once again, keep in mind, you got Semimaru and you got Higurashi also filling his head up with all this stuff. Like, you should have been the proper shogun! You, if it wasn't for Sukiyaki being born, you would be sitting on the throne right now! Now, even though that doesn't really make any sense if you stop and think about it for 5 seconds, but keep in mind, Orochi was, like, a little kid when he found out about this, right? He'd be like, yeah, you know what, old witch? I think you're right. If that baby wasn't born, I'd be shogun, because my grandfather tried to betray everybody. It makes sense! You know, like, if you're an adult, you'd probably look at that and be like, wait, that doesn't... The Kozukis have been shoguns for hundreds and hundreds of years. And so, yeah, and your father tried to kill people to usurp the position. This seems rather cut and dry, right? Oh, man. So, honestly, like, what should have happened, like, straight up, like, all right, here's what should have happened. Pappy Kurozumi should have been tried for his crimes. You know, that's the law of Wano, and probably would have still ended up getting executed with the seppuku and everything. But you can go, maybe, look into, like, your conspirators and everything. Like, maybe he was telling his wife or his brother or his sister or any other family members immediately. And sure, you know, arrest them for conspiracy against the crown. But, I think the whole, like, persecution of an entire family, like, generations later, it's kind of a little bit of overkill there. Now, it fits the themes of One Piece 100%. You know, because the government of One Piece, and this isn't even the world government we're talking about here, this is the Wano government, it's a completely different, separate thing, but even in those regards, they're very similar in that sense, where it's like, no, we don't have this, like, fair and just sort of thing, no, we definitely go along more with, like, the sins of the father will go to the sins of the son and the daughter and all of the grandsons and granddaughters in that family line. Like, basically, whenever a family commits a crime, they are essentially just, you know, their entire family is blacklisted, as I said. You know, that's how the world government does it a lot of times, like, with the Rogers family line. As if to imply, like, when Roger has a child, the child is gonna come out of the womb, like, I'm gonna be the next king of the pirates, and the world government's like, no. Well, I mean, like, not really. I mean, Ace didn't want to be king of the pirates his entire life. He was like, I'm gonna be a pirate, and then I'm gonna be my own pirate, and then Wiper got involved and everything like that, right? So yeah. I feel bad for Orochi as a child, but I can't continue. I can't condone the, like, continuation of the vicious circle kind of deal, right? Now, I'm not like I had high hopes for Orochi here. Not like I had the guy literally named after a slithering snake to be like, wait a second, I'm going to end this cycle of hatred. Yeah, like, obviously that wasn't going to happen, right? So yeah, you know, like I said, he's got conviction to it, and at least, like, he's embodying that, like, true evil villain nature, right? I mean, many of you could say it's cliche, it's stereotypical, like, he's the villain that's like, I am evil! But hey, at least Orochi is not like, I'm gonna rule the world! Like, not really, he's just like, hey, I'm just going to run this country into the ground because they ruined my life, and then after I'm dead, I'll be dead, so I don't care about it anymore. I'm not gonna be around to rule over, and I'm not gonna be around to spend all my riches and dance with my harem if I'm dead. So at that point, you know, whatever, that's what I'm here to do. So, I mean, if anything else, like, he's just, like, straight up chaotic evil, and he's, like, throwing it in your face. I'm like, all right, that's the kind of villain we got. And it doesn't even, like, keep in mind, at the end of the day, Orochi is not, like, the only villain in this arc, of course. We have Kaido, who kind of holds all the power, if we're being straight up. So, Kaido is the main enemy here that the Straw Hats are gonna have a hard time taking down. But Orochi just presenting himself just after years and years of this, and, like, but here's the thing. He's a chaotic evil, you know, bastard, but he's a chaotic evil bastard that's, you know, he's kind of won, in a sense. Like, he did kind of win. I mean, like, even if they defeat Orochi right now, like, I'm not saying, you know, Wano is completely past the point of no return, but it's probably going to take a lot of years, a lot of decades to get Wano back up to the place that it used to be, right? Like, so much of the land has been polluted and destroyed and deforested. So many of the people have just been starved, you know, like, this has been going on for about 30 years now, or right around 30 years when Orochi came to power, right? So even if Orochi were to drop dead of a heart attack this instant, someone like Light Yagami just took out the Death Note or something. Oh, thanks, Barry. Takes out the Death Note and just Kurozumi Orochi, you know, it's not going to be a quick fix and just like, oh, okay, the country's fine now. I'm like, no, it's going to take years to recover, and Orochi kind of like left his mark on the country permanently. Like, I'm sure the people of Wano will never forget about what he did, and hopefully they'll serve it as like a lesson to the future on how to act, you know? Like, for example, like, I don't know if there's, I guess there's nobody else of the Kurozumi family left, because Higurashi and Semimaru are dead by the time of the present storyline. Kurozumi, I mean, he has a harem, but he doesn't look like he has a wife or any kids. Maybe that was by choice. Maybe Orochi was like, I'm not having any kids because Wano's not going to last for my kids' generation anyway, right? But I was going to say, like, even if Orochi did have children, like, let's say he did, and they decide, you know, they the Straw Hats win, they defeat Kaido, they dethrone Orochi and they take him out and they execute him or whatever, if they decide to punish his family, like, that's just perpetuating the cycle, right? So maybe that's the overall message Oda's trying to get across here, like the vicious circle kind of deal. But yeah, what do you guys think? Let me know in the comments below. Yeah, this will be Tekking101 signing out. Later, everybody. I'm up to Order of the Phoenix. This is the tough one. This is the rough one. It took me about 2 weeks to get through Goblet. I don't know how long it's going to take me, but if I can get through Order of the Phoenix, I think we'll be smooth sailing from there on, because Book 6 is actually pretty short compared, and then Book 7 is like around the same length as Goblet. So, okay, here we go. It also has the badass cover. It is like, I love the blue cover. I mean, it's pretty damn cool, right? All right, moving on up.